A very good evening, everybody who is joining us live on this Facebook stream of our first segment of the eQuest, which is the case study presentations. It gives me a lot of happiness to welcome my students, of course, the teachers, the team of Skillshare, and our very eminent judges. Without any further ado, let me just begin introducing the person behind, the brain behind this entire concept of eQuest, Mr. Ananj Prasad. I really don't think there are many people in the ELPRO fraternity who would not know Ananj and his team at Skillsphere. Ananj has been associated with this school for over 7 years now and has been instrumental in a lot of programs for our young learners. Ananj is the founder and managing director at Skillsphere Education. He is a gold medalist graduate from Mumbai University and then further went on to pursue his master's in energy economics at the Ivy League Cornell University, USA. Thank God for his passion towards orienting young students in public speaking and communication skills that he founded Skillsphere Education, which so many schools across the country are using the services of. Ananj, with his team of trainers, has conceptualized various programs like Enlighten MUN, Emergence, Global Jigyasa, and LEAD, which our students have been making most of throughout so many years. So Ananj, thank you so much, and your platform now.
Thank you so much for the kindness, warmth, love, encouragement, motivation that we always get from Sugandha ma'am, from the management at ELPRO International School, and of course, most importantly, the students whose upliftment is our foremost objective, both at ELPRO as well at Skillsphere. And the eQuest is a very, very interesting event, which is going to give students another platform. There are many firsts that ELPRO International School has been responsible for. We actually hosted the first intra-school online quiz with ELPRO in India. We also hosted the first intra and inter-school MUN with ELPRO International School. And this is probably the first literary event of its sort that is being organized by any school in India over 2 days. And I would like to congratulate the ELPRO International School for taking up such an initiative and for giving Skillsphere Education the opportunity to take it forward. Today, of course, is day one of the eQuest, which always talks about infinite possibilities. And today we are going to be talking about the infinite possibilities in education. Moreover, the infinite possibilities in online learning. So we're going to be talking about different issues or different problem scenarios associated with extending online learning to all sections of society and teething problems associated with it. Three sets of students are going to be presenting very wonderful case studies to all of us. And I'm sure the question answer session post that is also going to add to a lot of the different pointers we'd like to talk about. Right. I would not like to take center stage because it is not my stage to keep. It is the student stage. And I'd really like to thank the judges, very, very eminent judges who have come in today. Mr. Vikram Deshmukh and Dr. Shilpa from Flox Educon, wonderful educators, not only educators, wonderful members of the education ecosystem in multiple ways. I'm sure Jayant will be able to wax eloquent in much further detail. But more importantly, when we talk about the case studies today, the reason due to which these eminent judges are probably the most fitting for this purpose is that they understand the nitty-gritty associated with taking education to rural sectors and to all sectors of society and have been very heavily working on this along with governments and other stakeholders in society. So thank you so much, Vikram sir, Shilpa ma'am, for having joined us. I think it is a wonderful opportunity for the students to learn from you. And I hope you ask students questions that you know they honestly deserve to answer. Okay, it's one thing to come up with a presentation, students. It's another thing altogether to be able to justify our points. Okay, what we want you to do, students, is of course, this is for everybody who's joining us on Facebook. We would actually like to start off a discussion. You would like to start off, you know, discussions on multiple perspectives. And more importantly, students, we would like you to realize that it's very important to suggest pointers. But what's a lot more difficult at times is to be able to implement them. Okay. So we want you to think about the implementation. The objective is not simply all of you speaking today. Yeah. So I hope you'll make the most of this opportunity. I know all of you for a lot of time now. Wonderful students, infinite possibilities for all of you. And I hope you are able to converge together at this wonderful occasion to give us an enlightening experience. And without much ado, I would like to introduce Jayanth Rajan, the manager for schools at Skillsphere Education. Sugandha ma'am, of course, said it's my event, but it's actually Jayanth's event. Jayanth also manages all our schools in Pune, especially Elpro International School, which is one of our most important schools in India. We are a part of the family. So Jayanth, I would like you to take this forward, and I would like you to ensure that the students show their thunder and they show their charisma to this wonderful audience that's joining us on Facebook today. So thank you so much, audience, for joining us, and I'm sure it's going to be a great experience.
Yeah, thank you, Anansh, for that. The ever modest Anansh. This is obviously his the brainstorming of it. Right now, going on to our judges, to give you a little bit more information regarding our judges. Dr. Shilpa here is the founder and director and chairperson of Team Flocks Educon Private Limited. It's based out of Pune. She's a dentist by qualification, a yoga trainer, and a trained Bharatnatyam dancer. That's a lot of things packed in one person, who strongly believes that we evolve and our passions do too. Is passionate about every aspect of school education, from administration and legal framework to mentoring teachers and students. She loves to write and has, to her credit, a few poems, street plays, and skits and stories. She's an educator who believes that learning is a lifelong process. I'm sure a lot of us agree with what she feels. Going on to the other judge here with us, Mr. Vikram B. Deshmukh. He's an associate edu-legal director, Team Flocks Educon Private Limited. Mr. Vikram has diverse experience of working in sectors like land acquisition, SE or special economic zones, franchising, preschools and schools. Mr. Vikram has good knowledge of legal framework of school education system in India. He has research paper to his credit about comparative analysis of fee regulation acts in six different states. He was associated with many schools across Maharashtra as strategic partner in solving various issues regarding the Right to Education Act. Mr. Vikram pursued his graduation in economics from Ferguson College in Pune and completed his degree in law from Symbiosis Law College, Pune, one of the renowned law schools across India. The idea or the beginning of Flocks Educon is founded by educational professionals with aim to provide value-added services to educational institutes. We offer school project feasibility, report, guidance about formation of school, edu-legal consultancy, affiliation know-how, designing fee structure, in-service teacher training, strategic planning for marketing and promotions. Team Flocks Educon also provides standalone services, like obtaining state permission, recognition, NOCs, guidance about CBSE, ICSE, IGCSE, IB affiliation, fee fixation. We also, Flocks Educon Private Limited also works with schools as edu-legal consultant on retainership arrangement. They are now operating in three states, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, and Telangana, with around 120 schools for different assignments. They have a comprehensive range of services covering the entire spectrum of teacher learning process. They have played a key role in various high court cases related to the RTE and Fee Regulation Act, which resulted in landmark judgments in favor of school management. They are very passionate about creating awareness and building capacity for all stakeholders involved. Their aim is to be the best consultancy provider of legal and academic services for educators throughout continuous upgradation of technology, bringing best practices under one roof and spreading knowledge through education and training. Their mission is to provide comprehensive range of services of highest standards under one roof, again, covering the entire spectrum of teacher learning process to educational institutes across the globe, not only India. It begins here by a dedicated team of highly competent, skilled, and committed professionals, maintaining the highest level of ethical approach in a student-centric environment. So that is information regarding Flocks Educon Private Limited and our judges present today here, Dr. Shilpa and Mr. Vikram B. Deshmukh. Moving on to the actual event, the first part of eQuest, as Mr. Anansh already informed everybody here, it's a two-day event. We begin with the case studies. And these case studies are analyzing and they're actually talking about something very essential, something that is very topical. It's going on in everybody's life. Online education and offline education, of course, they do not, they're not one without the other. We, during the lockdown, are obviously at home, and there have been state government rulings which have stipulated that online classes in schools can begin in some cases, and in some other cases, they may not, or they need to be paused, or they have to be only for so and so much time. All of that is great. Students still have to study. Education still has to continue. Learning still has to continue. So to better analyze this, to better make us understand how this is affecting people across different demographies in our nation, we are actually hosting this case study presentation. The first case study group that we have with us, it will be done by Kushagra Naram, Ishita Singh, and Ria Jagi. They are students from grades 11 and 12 of Elpro International School. Their topic is going to be measures to ensure better data connectivity for students in remote areas of India to ensure technology-driven remote education. I hope this is clear. We are not speaking only about making sure that people get books and people get, you know, uniforms and etc. This is more about bringing education online so that it could be accessible for everyone, everywhere across the country. So I think I hand it over to you students, Kushagra, Ishita and Ria. I'm sure you're going to wow us with your presentation. You may begin.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
And so sorry, just one point. All the audience and everybody else watching this currently, your questions can keep coming in on the Facebook page where this event is live. And the rest of us who are on this meeting, please do not raise any questions until and unless they're done with their presentation. You, I'm sure you already understand you have a time limit on it. So yes, please start.
Good evening to one and all present here. Today, the topic for our case study presentation is measures to ensure better data connectivity for students in remote areas of India to ensure technology-driven remote education. My team members here are Kushagra Narang and Ria Jagi. Now, I would request Ria to take over.
Education is what remains after one has forgotten what one learned in school. This rather famous saying by Albert Einstein perfectly reflects the fact that effective education is indeed constant and always evolving. In fact, the face of education has seen many changes over the decades. Once distinguished by the traditional classroom model, today education has metamorphosed into learning that is prompt, online, self-driven, and flexible. The journey of education in India has been dotted with innumerable milestones, most recently, technology-enabled learning. There are several challenges that are faced by students and children alike, including archaic, that is old-fashioned teaching methods, shortage of qualified teachers, highly disproportionate teacher-to-student ratio, and inadequate teaching materials that affects the quality of education. The basic ground realities pose as a barrier in the way of complete digitalization of education. Poor infrastructure, lack of digital facilities, lack of electricity, etc., still need to be addressed in remote village areas for a convenient access of quality education to students. Though the government has taken several initiatives in order to elevate the level of education via technology, especially in rural areas, there is still a long way to go. Service providers cannot afford to wire rural areas because of a large proportion of low-income families. Wiring rural areas is very expensive, and very few households can actually bear and support the cost. It is uneasy to see so many young generations with seemingly no hope to get an education in technology, which would help them to rise above the barrier that poverty brings with it. The problem with solutions offered by developmental agencies is that they are not customized to the local needs. They more than often just blame the rural people for being resistant to change and for not accepting the offered solutions. Another thing that I would like to bring to your notice here is that a study was done that showed that students who have proper internet access and broadband access at home achieve higher rates of graduation and much better job opportunities than those who do not. High-speed internet access is also strongly associated with greater economic development for communities.
So I would like to start my presentation by explaining how online classes came under the action and how it became so popular. During the COVID-19 outbreak, it was necessary to maintain the rules of social distancing. Schools and colleges were shut down and online classes were introduced, due to which everything had to go over the internet. With the government trying all options for education from online to television classes through community radio, online education has not got the desired response due to poor internet connectivity in remote and rural areas of the state. Many times, students had to go trek for a few kilometers in certain areas to get a proper signal so that they could attend classes or submit their assignments. The students who had connectivity to the internet were able to attend these classes, lectures, but the students without any connections to the internet are not able to attend any classes. If you ask us, how can we expect Wi-Fi connectivity in those areas who don't even have electricity throughout the day? So these students are suffering severely. But is it only the students that are suffering? No. The teachers from these areas, the remote areas and the rural areas, are also suffering and are going through a lot. No connectivity to a broadband again leads to teachers not able to take online lectures. Also, when the whole world is going through an economic breakdown, these teachers are too suffering a lot. They are suffering financially because they are not able to make enough money, again, because of no connectivity to the internet. As my partner Ria rightly mentioned, that the quality of education depends on proper infrastructure, sanitation, hygiene, and many more such things. But when it comes to attending an online class, it only depends on proper connectivity to the internet and appropriate devices. These students are lagging behind, which widens the gap between the people who have wealth and people who do not have enough resources. Thus, they don't get proper education, and this might lead to lack of job opportunities in future. This technological divide marginalizes developing countries and makes it hard for them to meet their technology needs. It is not just in rural, but children attending public schools are less likely to have access to computers, the internet, or high quality educational programs. The rural and urban divide is very depressing. Moreover, even within the urban area setting are the wide disparities in access.
India is home to the largest population of children in the world, with an estimated 43 crore children in the age group of 0 to 18 years in the country. These children are the future of our nation, and therefore it is imperative that they are provided with necessary means to realize their potential. A modernized education system can channelize efforts in this direction. Also, adding to the new needs of the education system comes the technological advances, which need to be most urgently taken care of. There are a few things the government can do to help the students of these remote areas to access the internet easily, which would help them in studying in a more technologically driven environment. Firstly, more and more towers should be set up so that data connectivity improves and students who have electronic gadgets available with them can have access to better internet, such that data connection does not become a major concern for students in the remote areas of the country. Education can be digitized in remote areas by providing multimedia teaching tools to teachers and engaging students through learning methods that utilize digital tools such as smart boards, LCD screens, videos, etc., to teach them different concepts, even if it is offline, and by making it possible for one teacher to deliver information remotely across several locations. In the Union Budget for 2018-19, the government's focus has been towards improving the quality of education by integrating technology. It has allocated ₹456 crore for digital education. The emphasis on the need to graduate from blackboards to digital boards signifies the role that technology must play in improving the quality of education. The role of NGOs in spreading digital education tools across Indian villages is also noteworthy. So, this budget could also be used in providing the students of these remote areas better data connections and finding out more ways and methods in which teaching could be done offline too. Another way is to share one electronic device among many people. Since many electronic devices stay connected in a region, it consumes much of the data of that place. The less number of electronic devices connected in a place, the better the data connectivity would be. Some students of a common locality could sit together at one place and one device could be connected rather than many. In places where internet connectivity is sporadic, unreliable, or intermittent, innovative approaches to caching and distributing digital content can enable offline access to vast numbers of online resources in ways that can simulate online environments. The emergence of low-cost e-readers is enabling groups to distribute vast amounts of information in digital formats to students who read them on small, purpose-built reading devices. Google has recently released a blog on how students can continue using Chromebooks and G Suite for education, even if they don't have the internet. IT teams can set up offline access on devices for everyone, but they would need online access to go through the process. Now, while doing the research for this case study, we came up with a new idea, which would cater to two needs at a time. First, being reducing the usage of paper sheets during examinations, and second, offline learning. As we know, many important exams in India, like the civil services, IIT, JEE, etc., are multiple choice based questions and answers. This means that OMR sheets would be used for these exams. If we give tabs to all the students in the exam hall and take it back as soon as the exam is over, we would reduce the usage and wastage of paper drastically. All the questions and answers would be in the tab, and these tests would be conducted offline so as to make it easier for students in the remote areas to take these tests. Also, these will not just focus on private schools, but government schools too, giving them equal opportunities to get digitized. Once the test is over, it would get automatically submitted to the server.
Development and evolution of any society depends on its availability and access to information. And the same is applicable to the remote areas of India too. Online education can work wonders in this direction and help the socially marginalized community to attain their entitlements given a strong and equipped basic grounds, infrastructure, and digitalized tools. My group and I would like to conclude our presentation here. Thank you. I hope you liked it.
Thank you so much, Kushagra, Rishita, and Ria. That was very well delivered. The eloquence overall was very, very good. The flow was very good. Now we go on to questions. Our judges, we're looking at questions from you first, if we can begin with you. Yes.
So when we are looking at interior part, or so what is their conception of, about interior part? Which part exactly they are considering as the interior part of India?
Interior part basically includes those people who don't have like access to, you know, in the rural areas firstly, mostly, and the, you know, areas in the countries like the city side or outside states who don't have access to such good, you know, facilities, internet connections, towers, all these things.
Okay, was that answer specific enough for you, sir?
No. I want a specific with an example that sharing that, okay, this particular village, this that area, how they will term. Otherwise, it is considered in the presentation that an area which is not having a connectivity is considered as the interior part. So I'm just want to know which specific area are they aware about. Okay, these are the parts in, say, Pune district. These are the parts of Maharashtra, or these are the parts of India wherein there is an issue of connectivity.
Sir, not in like, we're not aware about a specific state like Maharashtra or Pune, but we know certain areas like the hilly terrains, you know, in the northeastern sides, those areas, or Himachal Pradesh if we take, or the mountainous regions of India, those places don't have internet connectivity. So over there, we mainly need to focus and work upon.
They don't have exposure.
Exposure to?
Priya, may I please request you to stop your screen share?
Exposure to connectivity, exposure and internet, and they're therefore lagging behind. So we have to work on it.
Okay.
Any of the member, have you ever been in last say 4, 5, 6 years to any government school from Pune PCMC? Just to see, observe?
No, sir.
Okay. Maybe.
Okay, one of them says maybe, so I'm not so sure. So do we have to define a government school for you, whoever said maybe? if you'd like, Mr. Vikram, you can go ahead and do that. You can define what parameters qualify it as a government school. But right, I think the answer is typically is no over there with regards to them actually visiting a school like that. Yes. Follow-up question? Yeah.
So specifically when we look at the majors, so for the case study, what was the sample size or what was the source through which you collected all those data and how you authenticated the source of information?
The authenticated as in the sources, we've taken everything from the internet only. So we've taken everything from the internet, not the specific main sources.
Yeah, the main source was Google. And we see people every day around us,
right.
The children, the people from rural areas. I have my maid's son. He's not able to attend any online lectures. So we can talk to them too. Like, what are you suffering from? What are you going through?
And these are topics which are basically of common interest. Like, we hear about these topics every day in normal discussions also when we, you know, parents, friends, family, relatives. So from there also, like, we could learn about a lot of things.
Okay, moving on to the next question. So basically the solutions that they presented or the facts that they presented were more or less from sources, not exactly vetted through government sources or specific sources. Fair enough. Yeah, but I think that is something that they do need to keep in mind for the future presentations of this kind or any kind for that matter. Yeah. Moving on, any other questions? Yeah.
If, as a community member, I want to do some contribution in making that digital infrastructure available to rural students, what can I do as a normal common community member, as a normal common society member, not as in a government agency, not as an NGO? If as an individual I want to contribute something, what can I do? I mean, what anyone of you will do for that?
Any one of us, if we have money, that is, so we can just, you know, buy the digital devices and give it to them. That is like the easiest thing. But since that is not possible for everybody, you know, like if we have money, then we'll do something for ourselves rather than, you know, buying or doing something for others. So as people.
But also if this COVID period is over, then we can go to them and then we can teach them at least the basics of everything.
If people from 11th and 12th standard, we can't go and teach them, but at least the small children, the basic small things, the basic things, yeah, up to, yes, 7th, 8th standard.
If we look at them, we are financially, if we look at us right now, we are financially a little more stable compared to people we are talking about right now. So I think from our side, we can make short, small contributions, just like, you know, to organizations, to NGOs, whoever like works for that. And I mean, it's like, it's a small step, but I think it adds up.
One more thing which we can do as people is, you know, pressurizing the government agencies. Like, we can just say that, you know, 456 crore rupees is given for digital education. But is that really being used up right now? Or is the government actually using it for the people and giving, you know, allocating that much? So as a community, as a group, if we sign up some petition or we go to the government offices and pressurize them for putting that actual money or showing the results, because we have right to information, right? So using that and, you know, actually getting all the results and getting it done in front of you, we can also do that if you're responsible citizens.
We can do
a suggestion from my end. If you, as an individual, if you want to contribute, knowing that you don't earn, so you will be spending money from your parents, so it is dependent on someone else, but as a part of a community, if you can take a drive of any equipment which is lying idle at your place, so maybe we are switching over to the upgraded cell phones, and we might have an Android which is lying on, so which is unutilized. So even if you work out on that,
a small
donation drive, okay, the unused equipment which is lying at families with like us, so we that can be
Yes.
That was what I was expecting, actually. It is not always about money. It is about how it is always about a willingness. So it is not about capabilities also. So there are a lot of people who we might think that are capable enough, but are not willing enough. And if you are, I think Anansh always will talk about it. If there is a will, there is a way. So
yes,
in a similar manner, so everyone can contribute, but we should be willing to do it. And it was a good presentation from all of you. It was a good thing to listen to it and understand what is the level of exposure which you have for that type of area.
And considering the COVID-19 situation, it's uncertain times. All of us are going through lots of pressure. The future is at the moment, we don't know what is going to happen with our schools, colleges and academic schedules. In spite of that, you people have coped up with this digital way of learning. And apart from that, you are participating in a competition, taking extra effort, collecting data, analyzing at your end. It's really commendable. I congratulate all of you for that. And we are really happy to see the way you presented everything, the way you have made your PPTs. And also, Alec Jayan, I must congratulate you also for making all these people to go through this process and equipping them to make such a good presentation with proper professional flow. And thank you so much for putting
certainly it. Thank you, ma'am, for your kind words. Thank you, Dr. Shilpa and Sir Vikram for that. Yes, I think the last suggestion given by Mr. Vikram was actually very intuitive. Something that can be done, doesn't require need too much effort, but it's a very it's a small gesture, goes a long way. Of course, and yes, very well done. The group one, you were very good, very methodical. Sir, yes.
Sir, I would like to say that it was a pleasure to our knowledge. Like we got to know many things. So yeah.
Right. So I have a question before we go on to the next theme. One of the things that you two spoke about during giving examples to the judges was speaking about Northeastern region or mountainous region. We don't really need to go that far, but even if we take that as your example or that as your case, so have you thought of the logistics problem that exists? And have you thought of a way around the logistic problem that exists? When we are trying to overcome this issue of, you know, providing digital education to those areas as well, right? It's unavailable. So did you consider the logistic problem and then steps to overcome it? Is that something that you looked at as a team?
So, I didn't get your question. I could not understand. Could you be more specific?
Yes, of course. The question is, you said, okay, let's say Uttarakhand, okay? Some very, very far off area of Uttarakhand where we are certain that connectivity doesn't really exist. There is no data connectivity. So now that we know it doesn't exist, data connectivity is lacking over there. And we know that it is a very northeastern region of the country where it's quite difficult to reach, right? When it comes to infrastructure to develop data connectivity over there. So we know this. So did you consider the logistic problems that people encounter or companies encounter or governments encounter and means and ways around this logistic problem to deliver data connectivity? How would you do that?
Yes, sir. The problem is very simple, and the problem everybody knows about it, internet connection, because there are such reasons and the regions there, those places, it is very, very difficult for doing it. So as we can see, again, I'm talking about the budget which has been allocated to the government. If the private sector over here, the private companies, we have many private companies, if they try to step into this and they, step into this and they help people to, making, towers and all these things, because we can clearly see that development mostly happens, if you want it fast, it happens through these private sectors only, not the public sectors. So if the special economic zones, we have many special economic zones in Uttarakhand also, I guess. So over there also, if these private sectors try to step in and, help a little, so it would be really beneficial.
Okay, great. While that answer is all right, I would request all of you to, when you do this next time, maybe it's in some other event, in some other forum, I would request you to use less ifs and a little bit be more sure about what you're saying. So that means that you just need to go back to the drawing board and research a little bit more. Fine. Moving on to the next team now. Thank you so much for patiently taking that question as well.
Thank you, sir.
Case study number two, team number two. This will be presented by Diya Jindal, Nandika Agarwal and Khanak Patwari. The topic for their case study is integrating online and offline learning post the lockdown. So now we are going, we are doing a little bit of a fast forward where we know what is happening and we are looking at it 6, 7, 8, maybe 1 year also, or maybe more than that. So we're looking beyond this timeline and we are looking at integrating both these facets of learning and education and how can it actually work? How can it actually materialize? That is what the second case study is going to address. So let's have you on screen, Diya Jindal, Nandika and Agarwal. You guys here? I hope you're all ready. You all ready?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, yeah, wonderful. So I think we can begin. Let's begin.
Yes, sir. I'll just share my PPT.
Sure. Please share your screen and let's start. The same rules apply or the same standards apply. Let's wait till the case study is done before we ask our questions.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Today, we are going to present our case study on the topic integrating online and offline learning post-lockdown. The COVID-19 has resulted in schools shut all across the world. Globally, over 1.38 billion children are out of the classroom. As a result, education has changed dramatically with the distinctive rise of e-learning, whereby teaching is undertaken remotely and on digital platforms. The face-to-face education has experienced a remarkable change in the last 10 years. Although face-to-face education is still considered the norm, but acceptance of online courses is increasing in the field of management and engineering. Some of the reasons for the exponential growth of online education is that it is instant, online, anywhere accessible, self-driven, and on the go. The government of India is supporting online education to improve education quality and reach through the Digital India Initiative and launched program like Swayam, that is study webs of active learning for young aspiring minds. Top management institutes of India like IIM already has started using integrated approach for teaching the executive program courses. This transition from offline to online learning has reaped many benefits which may help in future education. However, both of them have their own problems that can be resolved by integrating them. Insufficient digital infrastructure. Most schools have adopted measures to conduct online classes, but neither the students nor the teachers are sufficiently equipped for online learning today. Although Government of India is taking initiative to develop digital infrastructure, but a lot needs to be done in this direction. High-speed internet and stable power supply are the biggest problem. India stands 89th worldwide on internet speed and stability. According to the report of the World Economic Forum, only 55% of the households have access to the internet and mobile broadband remains accessible to very few. After normal schooling is resumed, the students in areas with lack of infrastructure and remote areas that were not able to attend online classes will have to cover a lot of portion in a short period of time, thus eliminating the whole advantage of online learning. Limited interaction. Since online education can be accessed at home or any other convenient place, there's very limited direct interaction with the teacher and other people doing the course. Online classes have led to huge variation in quality of learning. According to a research, especially those courses which are self-paced, there's very less discussion among the peers. Most of the discussion takes place through email, chat room, or discussion groups. There isn't any campus atmosphere to improve social interaction. So you're not able to develop any social links which do help in career growth. Non-availability of qualified teachers. Return to offline is a necessity, but there's a problem of non-availability of adequately qualified teachers and experts at every location and scheduling seamless lectures with them. Dealing with change. The current time is of frequent change and it's difficult to adapt to latest changes in offline method of delivery. It can be adapted easily through online methods of teaching. Students' holistic development. socio-emotional, holistic development, physical development of children, social attributes, culture, camaraderie, and basic human values of living together as a society cannot be developed through online education. And last, language of the course. India is a multilingual country and a vast majority of the population comes from rural areas. The content offered by most of the online courses is in English. Hence, those students who are not able to speak English struggle with the availability of the language content.
Now coming on to the need for education. In today's digital world, education has become seamless, affordable, inflexible thanks to digital learning methods. But conducting offline classes have become a problem due to the pandemic. Many schools have large class strengths that can pose a risk to their health. Apart from that, offline classes are of limited nature. It is limited to the knowledge of the provider and physical environment around the child. They get homework in the school premises and playing, writing, learning happens only during those 6 hours. But integration will help us go way beyond that. If a child didn't understand a topic in class, he can make use of YouTube or other online platform to clear his or her doubts in a better way. The Open University in Britain has found out that the online courses equate to an average of 90% less energy and 85% fewer carbon dioxide emissions per student than offline courses. But conducting only online classes is not feasible. Increased screen time and less physical activity can be detrimental to the health of our new generation. Gadgets might also become a source of distraction for the students. We need healthy and productive youth to boost the development of our country. These days, companies no longer require academically excellent manpower. They look for skills like cooperation, people management, teamwork, communication skills, etc., which can only be developed through physical interactions with people in an offline system of education. In a physical class, they get a feeling of competitiveness that helps them cope better with the stress of entrance exams. It becomes easier to ensure if students are paying attention in class. Now, let's see what will be the effects of the integration. Online will not be the default mode of education, but it will become an important and integral component of learning. It will become a major tool to maintain social distancing without compromising the education of children. Through integration, some portion can be covered online and some can be covered offline, while ensuring that class strength is less in offline mode in case COVID-19 is not completely eradicated. This can create an affordable and flexible model of education. Besides continuous digital monitoring, multidimensional and multimodal learning is possible, which can be seamless across devices and independent of the time of the day. Instead of seeing offline and online learning as two separate modes of learning, the world post-lockdown can experience an amalgamation of both of them, creating seamless opportunities for children to learn and develop.
My fellow presenters have very well explained the advantages and necessity of the blended online and offline education in today's new normal. Also, they have shared the reasons of why a complete integration of online and offline education has not yet been successfully carried out by a majority of schools across the globe. So now, we can brainstorm the solutions for this seemingly impossible integration. The first step is to create and spread awareness for bringing a change in the rigid education system like ours. A suggestion would be that workshops are held in various cities to ensure that schools are first introduced to this new concept. There are many people who are very skeptical of the present technological developments, and many of them would not welcome online education with open arms. Sample classes should be taken in these workshops to give an idea to the children of what it would be to study in such a class and for the teachers to be able to understand their role in such a learning environment. Most importantly, input has to be taken from both the teachers and the students to understand what kind of issues they are facing in the current system and what adjustments would suit them best. It's high time that a student-friendly education system was to be developed by taking their feedback into consideration. In many private schools, equality and equity for all sections of society is not there. Many students do not have the same Wi-Fi availability as others and lack access to good internet. To ensure equal opportunities for all, the central and state governments must invest in uninterrupted free broadband and free access to the collaboration apps like Microsoft Teams, Zoom, or Google platforms, which will lessen the financial constraints for those who cannot afford a quality online education. Will the free Wi-Fi and free apps solve the problem of financial constraint of underprivileged kids? No. The biggest financial bottleneck for the online education is the availability of the devices itself. Not everyone can afford even the basic devices required for online education. Solution is, again, to some additional investments from the government itself. An example of an already tried and tested intervention is a mini personal computer called Gamma Tutor, which has been developed in South Africa. This is an offline device preloaded with interactive learning material. These resources have been specifically designed for South African school conditions and could be altered to suit the conditions in other countries as well. The Gamma Tutor software package is a learner support resource for after school hours. It will fit in the palm of a hand and will require no data and can be navigated by the click of a mouse. Its small size will make the device easy to keep and safe to take it wherever it's needed. It's well known that major educational challenges exist in schools as a result of a country's multi-language society, particularly in the teaching and learning of mathematics. The applications of Gamma Tutor will offer mathematics concept explanations in 8 indigenous languages, and more languages could be added to ensure that every child is provided education via their preferred medium. The device will cover the full curriculum for high school maths and physical sciences, presented in video, PDF, or animated PowerPoint format, along with glossaries, exam revision support, translation from English into indigenous languages, and many additional teaching support materials, and can be used for interactive teaching online and remotely. Another issue is of teachers not being sufficiently equipped for online teaching. Schools should onboard competent content writers for developing, validating, and uploading high quality 20 to 30 minute micro lessons on the school curriculum, as well as best practices of online teaching. Then the micro lessons should be made available to all frontline teachers to bring effectiveness in the whole integrated education system. Finally, I think as we have all grasped the fact that flipped learning is very much possible with teaching methodology that makes the student protagonist in his own learning, promoting an active, investigative, and collaborative learning. In flipped learning, what will happen is that a student will learn via technology the subject, the chapter from home and come. And once they arrive at school, they will be involved in an active discussion where they will be the active, where they will become an active participant in the present in the classroom. So let us all work towards making it a reality, which is surely going to be the future of education soon. With that, I conclude my presentation. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, team number two, for that very enlightening and illuminating case study. You did cover a lot of aspects with regards to the online and the offline platform, which is there. And if we have to actually integrate it, how do we actually go about doing it? A lot of it was covered. And it was delivered very nicely again, very still, very poised. Enjoyed that. Let's go back to the judges. Any questions? I hope there are questions. I'm sure there are questions.
So as far as this particular topic is concerned, all of you are objects of this case study because you were experiencing the classroom learning, and now suddenly after COVID-19 pandemic situation, you are suddenly switched over to online learning. So what are your personal experiences about this online learning process? What kind of problems you as an individual are facing in this system of learning? We just want to listen from you.
That's great. Any of you can start off, and then the others can also join in.
So basically, online learning is not basically that interactive as offline learning. One major drawback that I personally felt was that if we didn't understand a particular topic, sometimes a child takes time to grasp the things that is going on the screen. But the teacher might not even realize that. When they're physically present, the child feels more confident to ask questions. But in an online mode, they just don't get the feel for that. So that can be a major drawback. Apart from that, the teacher might not even realize if the students are paying attention or not. The children have turned off their cameras, and many children don't even reply to the calls of teacher. So that becomes a problem, that whether the teaching is effective or not, whether the child is learning or not. And if we have further doubts in offline classes, after the class ends, we can approach the teacher in the lunch break or during any free period to clear our doubts. But that is not very feasible in online classes.
Okay. Thank you, Khanak. Do the other teammates also want to add something on to that?
It's just that also there's the problem of Wi-Fi connection, and sometimes in many societies there's power cutoff. So there's the problem that you can't attend the classes. But yeah, it again has an advantage that you can see the recorded lessons, lectures again, which you can't do in the offline one. So if the child feels a little less confident on a chapter, you can go over the lessons again to ask the teacher. But yeah, Wi-Fi connection is a major problem over there.
Right. So then that basically ties in with the first topic that we had, where how do we get better data connectivity, right? So they're all linked, of course. So you can't solve one without solving the other. Right. Yeah. The third teammate as well. Would you like to add something to it? Yes, Dia.
Yes. Thank you, sir. What I personally feel that one of the major disadvantages of this online education has been that I'm not able to convey how I truly feel to the teacher. It feels as if there's a gap in between and I'm just talking to a screen, and it does not feel as if the teacher is physically present. So if I have a doubt and the teacher has already moved on to the next slide in front of so many, I know that there's other people on the call, I'm not able to build up the confidence to inform the teacher that I have not understood this concept. Can you please go back to the previous slide? It becomes more of a challenge online. And if it was an offline thing, then the teacher would have been right in front of my eyes. She could have possibly seen that I had not understood the concept, and she would have taken a minute or so for to let us grasp it. That's what I feel.
Okay. Well, thank you. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
So the way she said, sometimes kids are not attentive and teachers are not able to monitor it or make it out from such a distant places because the mode of learning is online. So can you suggest few solutions which we can incorporate as a schools, as an educators, wherein we can also monitor our kids while conducting online classes? You as a team have any innovative suggestions or solutions for that?
Very, very good question.
We can make it sure that the videos of the students are kept on, and if they don't turn on their videos, then they won't be marked as present. So they lose on attendance in that manner. At a small level, that can be done.
Yes. Enough. As a consequence, I think most students wouldn't really say that's a lot that they're losing. But that is something, surely. Is there something else that one of you would like to add to that answer?
In fact, I'd like to also ask you something. You talked about some of the cons of online education in general. You talked about the issues associated with attentivity of students. You talked about the overall supervision of learning that teachers might not be able to do adequately. You also talked about data and connectivity issues associated with it. There are these cons associated with online education, which definitely exist. There's no doubt about it. There are ways, there are definitely a lot of workarounds which teachers have worked on, and everybody has evolved along with COVID-19. As the virus loses its zing, online learning is gaining zing. as we are getting more and more mature in this era. So that is really what is happening right now. So in fact, you all yourselves, a lot of students yourselves have actually suggested a lot of changes, which I believe are getting incorporated to make learning more fulfilling. But my question is, what about the pros? There are pros also of online learning. I would just like to know, since we're talking about the cons, let's talk about the pros. What are the pros?
One of it can be that while you're offline, like now CBSE has changed the syllabus. It has actually cut the syllabus more and it has introduced more syllabus. So when the teachers are online, they can actually provide more worksheets for it and they can do work instantly and like cooperate to that. But when you're offline, you actually take days to do that. Plus the textbooks, like the textbooks which are government-based, they do not change at least for a year. But teachers themselves can do it through online method. So that's a pro.
All right, fair enough.
Could I also add to that, sir?
Yes, yeah, go ahead.
Yes, what I believe one of the major advantages has been that we've got an experience of what an online education would look like. With the modern world and technology developing at a very fast pace, this was very important. And I think this has been one of the major advantages. Like, coronavirus has actually been a boon to us in a way that we've finally realized the need that, you know, at any possible time, there might be an emergency where we have to shift to it. So we have to look into solutions for that now. It's really speeded up the process. And the thing with online education is that teachers can monitor our progress much more easily, and data tracking and those things become much easier. And their PPT presentations are much better developed, and they can explain via that videos. There's a lot of new concepts that they're able to explore, and artificial experiments are being conducted by our teachers that simulations that they are using to make us, that make sure that we are understanding while sitting at home. Thank you.
All right, fair enough. Thank you so much. Jen, please go on.
Yeah. Thank you for that very detailed answer, I think, from both of you. Any further comments or questions from the judges or anyone else?
We have been discussing since long about this online learning, that the elements which are missing in this part of learning are like, we are missing on a collaboration. There is no team building activities happening. There is no teamwork which is happening. But through this case study presentation, I can say it's an excellent showcase of the teamwork and collaboration. So I really wonder how we have incorporated, maybe knowingly or unknowingly, this part of teamwork and collaboration in this online studies. I think we as a team should analyze how these kids have worked together, staying at their homes, and created presentations and have coordinated everything so well. So they must have put lots of efforts. We all need to analyze what exact efforts. We need to decode that process, how it happened, so that it can become a part of online learning. So thank you so much for an excellent showcase of excellent teamwork and collaboration through this online platform too. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Shilpa, ma'am. And thank you so much, team number two, for presenting that case study very, very effectively and efficiently, and also answering and having a discussion with the judges here, honestly, with those questions. So moving on to the last presentation that we have scheduled for today. The topic for the last one is actually a little bit more complicated, because it looks at two things at the same time. So so that it's clear for everyone. The topic is preventing the educational divide between the rich and the poor during the lockdown. So this is quite complicated. If you're looking at it, you're also, first of all, trying to ensure that there is education provided to the rich and poor equally. That's first. And secondly, you want to do that same thing during the lockdown. I think the first step itself is quite difficult. And then we try to add that with the second step. I'm sure it's quite difficult. And I'm sure group number three has solutions and models and policies that could ensure that there could be less educational divide between the rich and the poor during the lockdown. So group number three is Srishti Sharma and Jennifer Ryan. You may start sharing your screen. Yeah, there you go. Yes, please begin.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. My partner, Srishti Sharma, and I, Jennifer Jain, are here before you to present the case study on the topic preventing an educational divide between the rich and the poor during the lockdown, giving a special emphasis on the situation in India. The disparity due to one's economic status has been prevalent since time immemorial. And as the entire world clenches to survive amidst a pandemic, this disparity is even more evident. Concentrating on the educational aspect, today we would like to present our case study to explain the magnitude of this problem, our solutions, and possible contributions to the same. Present before you is a brief roadmap that we made for ourselves to aid throughout this whole process of the case study. We started with identifying the problem at hand, collecting information pertaining to it, analyzing the current scenario, making a blueprint of the plan, and finally finding a way to actually executing this plan. Giving a brief idea about what our PPT deals with, here is a snapshot of a case study that summarizes the next 8 slides. First, we must realize that this COVID pandemic has affected an integral aspect, and that is education. Hence, a radical change in education propagation, along with funds and policies to implement them, and the provision of necessary resources are the need of the hour to continue in the lines of development and attain pre-prepared goals. Taking India into consideration, maximum support must be from the state government. Reiterating what was said before, we aim to give a student's perspective about the size of this issue, especially since we are blessed to continue on the journey of education without much hindrance, and aim to provide this same feeling of relief and security that we are getting education to the ones deprived of it, hence, as they too are going to be the future of our country.
The task of imparting education to the less privileged children is very challenging and presents several hurdles before us. In our presentation, we have attempted to accommodate the surface as well as the underlying problems. The first and the foremost surface obstacle is the inability to purchase gadgets. A 2019 report by Hindustan Times reveals that in India, 36% households are not equipped with the gadgets required for learning from home.
Taking the issue of electricity, though the urban lower class may have access to this basic resource, there are still a lot of villages who lack continuous access to electricity, and this being a major hindrance to the implementation of online learning.
Unavailability of qualified teachers is another major problem. Even though the number of teachers admitted to schools has risen, the competencies of the teaching staff are below par. According to the data of Unified District Information System for Education, 18% teachers in India in 2018-2019 had no professional qualification in teaching.
Failure in proper implementation of existing schemes and policies has always been a problem that we face, and hence is a constant aspect that may drag this initiative down. Hence, even if we come up with state-of-the-art technologies or near-perfect policies, not implementing them and thus affecting the ones in need is always going to slow down these initiatives.
Most of the unprivileged people are not even acquainted with the various ways which can be utilized by them to continue learning even during lockdown. Having stated the problem, we as students have devised certain probable solutions such as facilitating electricity supply, provision of digital appliances, fair implementation of the policies, access to quality education, channelizing platforms for nationwide interaction of students, and proliferating awareness. Now, we will take a closer look of each one of the proposed solutions. Facilitating electricity supply. When we talk about the rural poor, facilitating electricity is the founding step in imparting education during lockdown. Certain ways which we think can help in facilitating electricity supply are, firstly, the power from depreciated plants and unutilized capacity can be provided at concessional rates to the distribution companies. Secondly, imposing stringent laws and financial penalization in case of poor quality supply.
Then the use of non-conventional sources of energy, that is solar energy, hydropower, etc., should also be taken into consideration. For example, the decentralized renewable energy system in the Dharnai village of Bihar, which is the first village in India to be fully powered by solar energy. We propose that similar systems can be implemented in other villages as well. We have also evaluated the existing schemes and believe that the cost for setting up renewable sources of energy can be funded by extending the integrated power development scheme to rural areas as well, and also by using funds from the Pradhan Mantri Ujjwal Yojana and the Saubhagya scheme.
India has always considered education as an integral part of development, and hence 99,311.52 crores has been assigned for education in the fiscal year 2021. And this is exactly the basis on where we plan to procure funds. A significant amount of this amount is kept for infrastructure, grounds, meals, stationery, staff members, etc. This money can be planned and now used to obtain devices like smartphones, televisions, cable connections, or even help local cable operators for better accessibility for online classes. Provision of internet. This will also indirectly help in the digitization and smart village and smart city programs that are now prevalent in India. We also suggest a mode of community learning in areas where the virus isn't that prevalent or internet is an absolute problem, and so are funds. A handful of children living in the same area assembling together to study. This will not just help in better learning, but also better understanding. We have also stated a few notable examples that are currently prevalent in our world, like the Mobi Station, a UNICEF initiative in Uganda, BRCK, a connectivity device in Kenya that helps better internet accessibility, and well, the Kerala TV Education under the name First Bell, which is free on cable networks over the internet and has direct to home access. It may be difficult to implement the first two examples, but we would like to shed light on the route taken by Kerala. Very well known for having a 100% literacy rate in the state, we suggest other state governments to take a similar technique, if not the same, which can really help in curbing the educational divide between the poor and the rich.
Online classes through television, smartphones, and radios will completely eradicate the major problem of absenteeism among teachers and ensure more productivity. Online teaching also enables the higher authorities to keep a close watch on the teachers, their method of teaching, and ensure that only competent and skilled teachers are given the responsibility to shape the future of millions. Fair and square implementation of the schemes. We all are very well acquainted with the fact that every year the union and the state governments come up with different schemes to aid the less privileged, but the very long chain of executive increases the possibility of corruption and deceit. Reshaping the executive hierarchy for implementation of plans is an important suggestion which can be considered. According to us, in villages, the Gram Panchayat should be at the apex and the villagers at the heart of the executive. Similarly, in urban areas, the local administrator should be at the crest and be connected directly to the residents. This will help the government to understand the needs and actual requirements of the residents from the core. The government should also try to collaborate the work of local government along with efforts made by non-governmental and non-profit organizations like Make a Difference, Pratham, Akansha Foundation, etc.
As A4 mentioned, we students who are part of this presentation and many around us have access to resources and in this light are very privileged. Despite education being a need to aid a country's development, we often blame the government for their inability to combat this problem. But personally, my partner and I feel that we too must take part in this venture. And hence, we propose an idea. Channelizing platforms of interaction between students like us, to the ones in poorer households or from different backgrounds once the provision of devices and the problems related to online learning occur. This will help us to get a better view on their societal conditions and may even provide a new perspective for the ones on the other side of the call, get new information, or vice versa for us. Awareness of these platforms and plans can be spread through radios, by mouth, catchy advertisements, local announcements, etc., to let them know the benefits of education and why we stress upon universal education. Significant Indian platforms can be like, say, Namaste or Aha Guru, which are video calling, and study websites, respectively, can be collaborated with as a stepping stone to online education for all.
There are two sides to every coin, and so to our solutions as well. We have endeavored to critically analyze our solutions, and thus we have come up with some of the possible drawbacks of our proposed solutions. These are resistance from the government, time constraint that is implementing the solutions within a short span of time, lack of support from common people, reach that is reaching out to people who are actually in need, funds, arranging for financial resources.
As my partner stated the drawbacks, we will now like to let you know of the ways we thought to combat these drawbacks. First, resistance from the government.
Excuse me, TMC, please conclude in 2 minutes.
By suggesting the integration of provision of education and digitization into larger country developmental goals.
To gain support of the common people, we need to use various media such as television commercials, billboards, etc. to spread awareness about the importance of education to survive in this competitive world.
Time constraint. To help curb this time constraint, we propose a hierarchy model of personnel with according division of labor, thus obtaining maximum productivity, ideal output, and better time management. Reach. Being well aware of the population of our country and the population targeted, we propose a model to connect to the grassroots level, integrating the local government to help in the conduction of, say, surveys. Keeping the pandemic in mind, we also suggest NGOs and other people who wish to contribute who come in contact with them to get an idea of their needs.
To get money for implementation of the plan, we have already suggested a careful analysis of the available funds allocated for education, especially concentrating on the ones for infrastructure and diverting them into the purchase of devices and other needful appliances. Funds from schemes like Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao can also be used to provide the necessary devices to the less privileged girl child.
One futuristic idea that we have come up with is when the Dyson Neo census will be taken, that is in 2021, to add a column on who and how people are getting access to education. This will also help in formulating future education-related policies. These suggestions were propounded, keeping in mind a larger concept. With the demographic dividend that India's comparatively young population will bring in, a skilled and educated population will accelerate the overall development of the country, and the base for this being universal access to education. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, group number three, for that very, very, very good case study, actually, and very well explained to us, both of you, Shrishti and Jennifer. Very clear, it was the solutioning that you did was extremely good. I think it was more robust when I compared with some of the others. But yeah, that was very good. Let's go on to questions or comments from the viewers. Yes, Dr. Shilpa, Vikram sir, any questions or comments that you'd like to give? We'll begin with you, and then I think there are other people as well who might want to get in there.
As far as content and everything is concerned, I think the way you said, the overall presentation and the approach to the problem at hand was quite good. So that's there. At the same time, it's a divide which is rich and poor, be it a lockdown or a non-lockdown situation. So one will have to work out on it. And still the way there was a question which was asked by Shilpa for the first team. in what way you think you can contribute to it? Because all you are talking about government doing it, NGO doing it, and so as an individual, how you can contribute to it?
Yes, sir. Thank you for your question. So I think personally, the first idea that struck in my mind when you asked him the same question is all of us also have household helps and all of them have their children. So maybe in that very basic level, if you ask your own household help, is your child getting education? Is your neighbor's child getting education? Then you have an idea of all the people in that area. So that itself is quite a lot of contribution. And again, as NGOs and governmental organizations, they will want to have a list on the people who we need to help, like give devices. So even if we help in making the list, I think that's a very big step from our side, sir.
Okay, thank you, Jennifer, for that answer. I hope it is it's acceptable as a start. Of course, it's only the beginning. Right, ma'am, anything that you'd like to add or anything that you'd like to question?
So I one thing which I have in common for all three teams is how you selected the topics.
May I answer? So we went through all three of the topics, me and my partner, and we thought since the current situation is the problem of education in lockdown, because one of the topics is a futuristic idea and the other ones, I think, technologically based. But we thought this one, right now, we do know the divide because there are a lot of news channels and you can see the problems, like children are suiciding because they couldn't attend an online lecture. That's a major problem. So we thought if we research and we have a broader idea and we can pass this on, which is why we thought this topic was apt to work on.
Before you started researching on a topic of removing that or preventing the divide of rich and poor in a lockdown situation, so have you researched on what is the level of divide in non-lockdown situation?
Yes, sir. Because we all do know that there's always going to be a disparity. As I already mentioned, there's always been economic disparity. And I don't have the exact figures, but we did realize that there was a very significant population, not just in rural areas, but also in urban areas, where children, even if they had a school, they either wouldn't go for reasons like they had to work to provide for the family, or even if they had schools, they were willing, they didn't have qualified teachers, which again, we addressed the problem, or they had problems with other materials or equipments and books, like one of our previous teams mentioned their presentation. So yes, we do realize there was a disparity before lockdown too.
Have you, the same question which I asked for the first team, have you ever been to any government school or a aided school?
Yes, sir, I have. Been to one person.
Where?
I think it was a New English Medium School. I'm not sure. I think that was the name. There's a planetarium or something. So I had gone there as a field trip, I think. But yes, I did realize and I saw the school. Yes, sir?
Pune City, 12th Road.
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So what is the difference between the school which, or the type of school where you study and that type, those schools?
It's immense. I mean, at a glance, you will feel like you have the building. They have huge grounds. They have everything. But once you enter, you can see, like, when it was built, it was a very good establishment. But now the walls are faded. The walls are chipped. The benches are all scraped off or people have written on it. The boards are not properly cleaned. And even the charts are very haywire. There's no actual organization. And you can see that it's not the same quality that we have. Like when I enter the school, we have our teachers coming in, and once we come to our class, we have huge benches, a huge board, we have the books we need. I didn't even see lockers there. Maybe they were there at the back. I just had a sneak peek. So I think there were quite a lot of differences compared to our school.
Yeah. How you will define quality education? Because when we are talking about divide, we are talking about divide on that front.
Yes, sir. So here, quality education, according to me, is at least the same education, I mean, the same level of content, everything that we have. Like, we know there is a divide with the different boards. So, but then all of that, like, even if I'm a CBC student, my friend is a ICSE student, we at least know there's some part of the content which is the same. So maybe help you know, integrate that same content and make sure like whatever they're learning, maybe they have a different board, or I'm not exactly sure what they're learning, but maybe make sure at least the basic content that they're learning and we're learning is the same, so we're at least in the same platform.
When you said you are not sure about the content, so I will add on to it, almost the content with the state board, be it CBSE, ICSE, may not be the same, but it is similar the way you said. But the differentiator you talked about were different. When I asked what is the difference between your school and their school, is it only content which will define the quality of the education?
Not necessarily, sir. Maybe the way it is explained to the student, because one same content, I would be able to grasp it, someone else may not be able to. So maybe like qualified teachers, again, as we mentioned, there are a lot of teachers, but as my partner mentioned, not all of them at least even come to school. They're just there. So maybe at least making sure that the person who delivers this content has the same knowledge.
I would like to add to this, add to my partners that teachers, I'd say, are like the most important aspect in teaching, because it can be the case that the content we have is very good, but if the person teaching us isn't qualified enough, then no matter how much the what is the level of content, the students won't be able to take it far. And like at a personal level, I'd say I'm a person who connects a lot with the teacher. And I have experienced that sometimes even in the textbook, the content is not that much, but the knowledge that my teachers give me is something that's there with me to retain forever. So teachers are like the important aspect, and they are the ones that I think set the standards for the quality of education, more than content or the infrastructure or anything. Thank you.
Okay, Jayant, if you have anything.
Yes, sir. Okay. So that was wonderful. That was actually provoking, and there was a whole question back and forth that was very well done. Vikram sir had a lot of good questions, in the sense technical questions actually. Jennifer, well done. I think you tried to feed them as much as possible, as much as you have seen and observed. Good on you to remember your visit to that particular school as well. That really helped with the discussion, you know, going forward. Right. My question actually would be something along the lines that sir asked. And again, when we look at the educational divide of the rich and poor, yes, we accept disparity is there. So any thoughts on how we would actually overcome that? Forget the lockdown. It's normal. The lockdown is a very major problem, but let's, you know, beyond that.
Yes, sir. Can I answer?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Sir, first of all, again, we know the government has assigned funds, but we don't know if they're actually reaching the correct people, correct time, and if it's going for good use. So maybe making the RTI, the act more powerful, maybe give it a little more, you know, a little more power. So we actually get the answers and we see the same implementation. And I think, as one of the previous teams said, to keep forcing or telling the government that this is not happening.
So if I may interject over there, so this point was brought out by, I think, team number one as well. And this is to do with transparency. How funds are being allocated and what sort of what is the accountability for it, right? So this is that. Fair enough, transparency is required. But any concrete step that would lead to incremental betterment or reduction in this divide that we know exists?
Yes, sir. Again, as my partner stated, teachers. So maybe ensuring that the teachers who are reaching these areas are the ones who are teaching these students. They know what they're teaching, because again, as she, I've read it somewhere, I'm really sorry, I don't remember where, but they said a major percent of these teachers, even though they're teaching, they don't even have a degree to teach. They're just going there because they've been assigned the work. So maybe ensuring that. At the same time, we came up with an idea of an interaction platform between us and students from a poorer household or people who are being affected. So I think if that comes into, I know it's really difficult to get into reality, but if that comes, I think as students, we'll know what they're going through, and maybe then we can come up with our own ideas to help them.
fair enough. One last question. This is to all of you here, all of you.
I also have one thing to add. I think there is a misconception with us that teachers who are working with aided and government are not qualified. But it is a misconception. Why I'm saying it is a misconception. So if you go through a data of 2019 of all private schools across India, be it CBSE affiliated, ICSE or IGCSE or IB. So compared to government schools, if you check on the qualifications and eligibilities which are required to teach in India as a teacher, so you will find that with all government aided and government schools, all the teachers working over there are qualified because there is a defined process. I just wanted to add on this. And second thing before we wind up everything, one thing is that which I would like to suggest to them. So definitely it was appreciated that definitely the work done is very good, the way you researched on the topics. But the key when you are researching, when we asked for the first team also, is see to it that you are authenticating the source of information. What we have realized when we are working in school education is somewhere as a student, we get conditioned to believe that whatever is said by the teacher is right. I should authenticate it. Whatever is told by my parents is right. Definitely, they have experience. They have that authority to convey all those things. But as an individual, I should inculcate that habit of checking the authenticity of the source. And that's where the work which we are doing is what we have realized is that everyone was dependent on government officers as a source of information. And that source was never authenticated. And people went on doing something which legally might not be correct. So on the similar front, the way we made a comment, ki there is a problem with the qualification. No, there is no problem with the qualification. On the contrary, in 2019, when government decided on removing teachers, in accordance to right to education, teachers who are not qualified and eligible. So to everyone's surprise, 15 lakh teachers working across India with private educational institutes, be it CBSE, ICSE, IGCSE, IB, were found non-qualified. Because government has a structure to appoint them. And looking at that is one aspect which I would like to. So what happens is that when we make these judgmental comments, why we end up making this is based on our perceptions and assumptions. So as students, this is a learning platform for you. The job which you have done is definitely commendable, no doubt about it. And second thing is that all the team members, whoever decided on these topics and this line, definitely it is the need of the hour. Second thing, going ahead on this, we are similarly discussing with few schools on is there an option? Why I'm talking about is that you people have now looked at a situation is prior to lockdown and post lockdown. So now, Anansh, there is a discussion within the educators, can we have an option of online schooling? No physical school.
Uh-huh. Right.
And last week we had certain brainstorming sessions. Next week onwards, we'll be sitting at it and maybe Pune will see an online school. Second thing, when Anansh was asking about pros. So I think geographical limits is, you don't have those limits. So you can be any part. Only condition is that you should have a data connectivity.
Exactly.
So being that at any part of the town or any part of the world, you can still participate in the whatever learning process is there. That's what I wanted to add it on.
And one more thing I would like to add as far as this third presentation about poor and rich is concerned. The very first thing all of us need to change is our attitude. We are always treating underprivileged kids somewhere as a secondary citizens, be it the government machinery, be it the teachers working in those schools, be it we as a societal members of society or citizens of this country. We need to change that attitude. And I think that change in attitude, a best example as far as upgraded quality of government schools is concerned, Delhi government schools is the best examples. One should study how they have defined their processes, how they have changed the attitude of entire system. So they are also citizens of this country like us. They deserve best quality education. They deserve best quality healthcare facilities. So definitely change in attitude all of us and all these budding citizens of country is very much need as far as that poor and rich divide is concerned.
Thank you, ma'am, and thank you, sir, for that clarification and actually providing us this very important information regarding this this unnecessary misconception that we have regarding teachers that work in government schools and private schools, and also how different schools are tackling this problem of, you know, quality education. Thank you so much for that. Now, this actually brings us to the close of this particular event, for day one at least, and we would like to hear the results from the judges. Where do each of these
give me stand? A minute. I think Ananj can have a concluding
sure.
Yeah, adding on the numbers.
Absolutely. Okay, sure. In fact, sir and ma'am, I would also like to request you. I think one of the most important things that will come out of this session is, of course, great presentations. Firstly, congratulations to all of you students. I was very much a fly on the wall, as I promised, over the duration of this session. And I was witnessing, I also could not hold myself back and asked one of the groups a question. I would like to congratulate all of you for coming up with some brilliant points, very, very good points, very workable points. I like, the level to which you all have been able to think. Now, as Deshmukh sir and Shilpa ma'am correctly stated, that, you know, you can't just randomly come up with things and expect them to work. You have to really think about the next step and the next step after that and take it forward from there. Okay, you have to have a very balanced perspective in addition. You have to make sure that the sources that you're looking into are verifiable. So all of these things are very important. But what is equally important at this point in time also is to make the best of the current situation. Okay, if you asked us 4 months back as Skillsphere Education, or if you ask Deshmukh sir or Shilpa ma'am whether we could discuss the possibility of an online school 4 months or 5 months back, we would have all laughed at you. We would have laughed at ourselves if somebody asked us to possibly, you know, move everything online. But necessity is the mother of invention, and COVID-19 has given us the opportunity to realize that there is such a wonderful platform that exists for our utilization, all right? There are so many issues that can be sorted out via online learning, and that does not in any way disregard offline learning. But well, if it can't take place, learning has to move on. And online learning is something that's redefining the way we are doing things. I think, you know, a great man once said that the worst thing that we can do is not manage to live through a pandemic, but the worst thing that we can do is not to learn from the experience. Okay, so at this point in time, you know, we are learning through the experience. We are talking about education. You all are learning at so many social, economic, financial, even community levels. But what we can learn in the field of education is really everything related to online learning and how we can take it forward. At the same point in time, I feel that, you know, a lot of things that we talk about in popular discourse today are very privileged concepts. I was telling Sugandha ma'am the other day that, you know, the entire concept of social distancing in a slum like Dharavi is a privileged concept. Okay, it's very easy for us to sit around in the houses that we are sitting, where we have so much place behind us, free space behind us to sit and, you know, participate in a case study session without anybody disturbing us. Just go into a 12 by 12 foot chawl in Dharavi or in any other slum and then talk about 6 people living together and then discuss social distancing. Okay, it's just not possible. It's very nice to say these things. And that's why, honestly speaking, you know, I sometimes marvel at the fact that the Mumbai government and the Bombay Municipal Corporation was able to contain COVID-19 in a place like that. Now, when we come to, you know, discuss things like education for those students, okay, it's not simply about getting data to become available. It is not even simply about, you know, having stuff running on a TV. Okay, let's talk about your own households. If you have 2 siblings and your parents living together, each one of you would probably require a device today. Each one of you would require a device. You know, I'm sure there's a lot of juggling of devices, a lot of juggling of places taking place. And all of these things actually translate to the rural levels as well, or to the underprivileged sections of society as well. So the question that we are asking is that, you know, all of you are brilliantly privileged. Great school, great teachers, great everything. But what are we going to do to ensure that this economic divide does not grow? Okay. Obviously, we are not going to stop learning. It's not something that we did when we were offline either. We didn't decide to, you know, stop. We didn't decide to shut schools down because, you know, a government school was probably not the best like we were. We never decided to do that. We never decided to not have a panel discussion or a case study taking place via eQuest back then Quest because, you know, a student in a government school was not able to do so. Well, unfortunately, you know, these divides do exist in society. But fortunately, we do have the ability to effect change as far as this is concerned. So what you need to work towards is effecting this change. You need to effect this change. Honestly, a lot of this change can be effected in a much quicker manner online than offline. Much quicker manner. It's much easier to actually effect change by helping students from underprivileged sections of society online than if you were to actually go from school to school, school to school in the offline mode. Deshmukh sir, actually, I would like Deshmukh sir and Shilpa ma'am to also provide some realistic experiences to you all. Sir and ma'am asked you on multiple occasions, have you all ever visited a government school? Sir, I would like you all to give a little bit of a picture of the issues that when you are sharing the results, I would like you to share a picture of the issues that schools from the underprivileged sections of society are facing. Ma'am talked about government schools. I was very fortunate to go to one of the best schools in New Delhi, the NP Co-Ed Secondary School, that's in Lakshmibai Nagar. It's actually better than some of the CBSE schools I've seen across the country. It's state of the art. It's state of the art. So it's not that government schools are bad schools. Especially when you go to Delhi, I mean, I was shocked. I had a very preconceived notion, which was horrible. Yes, but there are issues with scalability, with systems, and these are things that, you know, you need to realize. Now, on a closing note, of course, we are going to have many discussions and you're going to hear a lot more of me tomorrow during the panel discussion and that we are also having in the debate as well. But what I'd like to tell you is that, you know, it's very difficult to, you know, typecast something as good or bad. There's actually nothing that you can really typecast everything as its pros and cons, unless you're talking about smoking, alcohol consumption and drugs, in my opinion. But yes, when we are talking about education, when we are talking about online learning, you know, there are going to be cons. And the funny thing is that if we were to have this discussion 4 years back, when I was at Cornell University, we were already using Zoom for sessions. It was way more primitive than what we have today. Okay. There was one-way discussion at all points in time. Questions were asked via a chatbot. Presentations used to lag. 4 years down the line today, this is almost as good as a class. Of course, if somebody keeps their video off and somebody doesn't want to listen, there's very little that anybody can do even in an offline classroom. But if somebody is willing to learn, somebody has that curiosity to learn, jigyasa, as they call it, my favorite word, there is absolutely no problem with the mode of education. At the end of the day, if you have willing teachers, if you have passionate teachers, you have passionate students, I believe online, offline, or online and offline, all objectives will be served. That is my personal opinion. And as much as every teacher, right from Sugandha ma'am to Pallavi ma'am to every other teacher and every other student is probably absolutely cannot wait to get back to the classroom and probably pull each other's leg and, you know, perform a lot of mischief, which otherwise gets muted on Zoom or on Teams or whatever else that you all use. We have to make the most of this opportunity. Learning cannot stop. And I'm glad that we are trying to actually put this entire discussion into further perspective via eQuest. Thank you so much, Deshmukh, sir, Shilpa, ma'am. It's been wonderful to honestly have both of you joining this discussion today. And I was telling Sugandha ma'am that there can't be better people because, you know, you are trying to be a part of this at so many levels. So students today are, you know, very good at going to Google and figuring out things and then thinking out of the box, coming up with solutions, but understanding how realistic they are, something that we have to give to them. So in fact, sir, while ma'am, while you all are providing the results, I would humbly request you to also provide a little bit of a realistic situation to them with respect to these three topics today.
Thank you for that closing note, actually, from your end. I mean, I'm sure, yes, all the content that was covered in the case studies was really good. Yes, Vikram sir and Shilpa ma'am, are we ready with the results?
Yes, we are.
Yes, it's wonderful. So I think, yeah, I hand it over to you to declare the results and also give us some insight and some realistic examples of what actually goes on in the schools that we discussed, the different kinds of schools that we discussed today.
See, even if we start with the first topic wherein we were talking about data connectivity, I think two major challenges which we discussed is electricity available and is data connectivity available. So when I said that, how you do a research. So data connectivity is dependent on the mobile network, one thing. Second thing, BSNL has been a major player with a wired communication. So when you look at that problem, why data connectivity is not there, or how one will get a data connectivity. So what is expected is that I need to know what is the way in which data connectivity is established. What is the journey of last, say, 20 years? So if you are aware about, your generation might not have seen pagers. So prior to 96, before the mobile network was launched in India, so paging was there. So when you look at that journey, so one should look at that journey of getting data connectivity. Now we are in, wherein the fiber optics are there and all those things are there. Definitely there are challenges. There will be challenges. Worldwide, there are challenges with data connectivity. So when you look at a realistic thing, data connectivity in this lockdown situation plays a key role in your learning being continued or discontinued. But at the same time, when Anansh is saying that a school, so the best school, one of the best schools from the government is from a Shirur district, Shirur Taluka, which is very near to Pune. So a zero energy school, Anansh. In that particular school, the initiative was taken by one of the teachers who is working in that school. Everyone will be surprised to know that admissions for next 4 years are booked. So if you want admission for next 4 years, there is no vacancy in that particular school. People, that there is a waiting list for next 4 years. At the same time, when I say government school, so maybe any one of you who is traveling from, say, your home to school, you will come across. So we have been to, we are working with PCMC to work on few schools to upgradation and all those things. So one school which works in two shifts, morning shifts is a girls' school, afternoon shift is a boys' school, first to seventh in Thergav area. So when we visited that school, so we had primary discussions with officials and even political leaders, but we were keen on telling them that you don't inform that we are going to see the schools. You give us the numbers of the school principals and all those things and location. When we went to the school, so it is seven classes, so seven teachers. That's the scenario. So there is, if the number of students are on, say, more than 200, then you have a pune. Otherwise, there is no non-teaching faculty which is allotted to the school. So cleaning needs, either the teacher will have to do it or the students will have to do it. We are talking about hygiene, the way Anansh talked about social distancing. So we are talking about sanitization, hygiene to be maintained. In these schools, there is no non-teaching staff which is available to maintain this. There is no manpower which is available. Our first-hand experience is definitely the, even the girl students where we went in, say, first standard, second, third, fourth, they were street smart. So if you look at, they have a better exposure to the life. All the difficulties are there, struggles are there. So maybe on road, when it comes to moving on their own, they are better equipped than all the students which we might have in our type of schools or our type of families. At the same time, definitely the way our team members, all three, explain on certain part, getting teacher to the class is a challenge. Teachers are there, appointed there, they are qualified. Second thing, Anansh, in last 4-5 years, there are a lot of donations which are going on. Maybe in the way of books, computers, but electricity availability is an issue. The faculty who is trained to teach. Second thing, when you look at NGO intervention in all these, specifically in Bombay or Pune, with all municipal schools, you will find, Anansh, there is a fight to get a hour in the school on Saturdays. So there are NGOs who are working based on CSR funding and who want to show that I'm doing some, taking some effort over there. So there is literally a fight for the time slot on Saturdays.
The NGO activities which are conducted in these government schools are not outcome based. So there is no accountability which we can fix for those activities. And as those activities, it's most of the times it's like wasting time of the students as well as wasting time of those facilitators. All those systems need to be set right if we really want to get some outcomes out of those CSR fundings.
There need to be an effort to define what do we mean by quality education. There has to be some benchmark. These are the minimum deliverables. So in any school, any student studying across India should get these minimum things. So that needs to be defined, wherein right to education made an effort in that regard in that direction. So certain aspects, at least on infrastructure part, were talked about, but it will take a lot of time for us. That's why my question was specifically when we are talking about that divide. So we'll have to define quality education. We'll have to define minimum deliverables and then making an effort. And when we said, is it possible? It is very much possible. Used as students, maybe once you are done with your 12th or something like that, even it will be a learning experience for you. Or see, whatever is part of a society will have to live and coexist together. Be it a poor, be it a richer one than us, be it a cultured one, uncultured one, be it a literate, illiterate. So everyone is part of a society, and we need to, Shilpa's and my opinion is that we need to train ourselves to coexist with all of this. So cohabitation is a key. And in that direction, it is better if we take these opportunities of exploration. Going to these schools once in a month will also make you feel how empowered you are, how lucky you are, how entitled you are, how blessed you are. Otherwise, as an individual, you might have a list of complaints about what your parents are not giving you, what you might not get. So there is a list, wish list is always there. So the best thing is that if you get an opportunity to see that, you will be able to know how better equipped we are. And definitely government schools are, there are examples wherein there is an improvement change across India. You find a lot of examples wherein there is a change in a positive manner, which is happening, but not need to be done. And one need to be sensitive enough. The way Shilpa said that we need to feel at heart. See, Anansh, I feel in my childhood, dignity of labor was talked about and practiced. I come from a family of farmers, so wherein I used to call anyone a labor who was working on the farming. So it was seen that all of us are calling them uncles. So based on their age, so if anyone from the same, say, financial data also comes, was given the same respect considering the age, and the same respect was given to irrespective of the person's job. So that dignity of labor was actually talked about and practiced, which is not happening. So the way these students gave example that we should speak to the maids and everything, I think this lockdown made us realize what is the role they have. So we always look at it that maid gives us 1 hour for a minimal amount, and we use that 1 hour for earning maybe 10 times, 20 times more than what we are paying that maid. So once you start looking at it, what is the value addition of these people? So when Anansh talked about Dharavi, if Dharavi stops working, I think half of Bombay stops working.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So they are the one who are putting their blood and sweat for the economy of Bombay. So you will not have drivers in place. You will not have a lot of support staff available. So at least 50% of Bombay will stop working if Dharavi stops working. So we need to understand and develop that approach. And end of the day, we are choosing different professions for livelihood. So which doesn't make any difference as such. So maybe I will choose one profession for earning certain amount. So if I'm earning, say, on a higher side, will not ensure that I'm a good person. So you should respect a good person. So the way I said, at least Anand said that certain things cannot be termed as good and bad. So on a thinner line, at least you should learn to treat a human as a human, and which is we need to learn through education, which is not happening in most of the schools, be it private or government. So I think need of our is to go back to a 40-50 year scenario, which was there in India, wherein always it was talked. Shala hai manushya ghadavnyacha sathi. So it is for developing and equipping human beings to be better human. So it doesn't happen. Maybe we are creating better professionals. We are giving better skill sets. But what we are missing in overall this journey is creating better humans. Is what is the need? I think if Shilpa has to add to something, and we will talk, share about the results. I think we'll not talk about the marks. We'll talk about So should we start with the third team, the team which ranked third or ranked first?
Third. We go with third, and then we
third,
go
third, second, and first.
Yes.
Huh? So So I think they are aware about the parameters which Anansh you shared. So the parameters which were given to us is pointers and content in presentation, public speaking delivery, presentation, ability to answer questions effectively, participation of all team members. So on certain, see, as far as participation of all team members, everyone is on a same score. So that's, there is a equality. On the third rank, team one is on the third position. Team two is on second position, and team three is on the first position.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for letting us know. So what we get to know is
share the score sheet with you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Congratulations, all of you. You performed very well, and the way I said in uncertain times, and the way you showcased your collaboration, I am amazed to see this, because you are sitting at your homes and then coordinating with your friends, coordinating with Jayant and probably Anansh, and then you prepared everything, presented it so well. Heartiest congratulations, and we are proud of you. The way you presented it, we are really proud of you.
And you need to keep up this. When I said at the beginning, if you are trained by Anansh, then this was expected.
Very kind of you, sir.
Yeah, very kind words.
Very kind of you, ma'am. Kind of you, sir. Thank you so much. In fact, Sugandha, ma'am, we have had a brilliant session. Lot of wonderful discussion. Lot of good food for thought. And in fact, the students have come up with some very good suggestions, which I think, you know, they should consider implementing. They talked about a device collection drive. I think that's what the first team talked about. A device collection drive. All of us have age-old devices that we replace from time to time. I think that would be a great idea. Why don't you all take it forward as 11th and 12th grade students? I'm sure the school's blessings will be with you. I really think you should do this. That's really the need of the hour. Been a part of a couple of such device collection drives at a very small scale, which have really worked out. 25, 30 devices have been collected. Nothing has been bought. And I can't tell you the amount of difference they can make. I mean, for you to get a device, it probably ensure that you get to play a couple of online games apart from, you know, attend your sessions. But for them, it's actually continuing education. Okay. So it's a great idea. So thank you so much. In fact, I'd love to take this discussion forward with sir, and I'm sure a lot of you might have questions. Sir and ma'am, you know, I like to call them hermits in ways, because you don't see them around too much, but they're treasure troves of information. And I'm sure they'd be very happy to talk to any of you students if you'd like to get any further food for thought, right? Sugandha, ma'am, thank you so much for the opportunity. All of you, you're going to see us tomorrow once again, having a great debate with the younger students of the school. And then a great panel discussion. And in fact, the school deserves a lot of credit. Online learning often becomes, you know, a topic that's a little bit of taboo. It's a little bit of a taboo among educational circles today. The ability to actually address the positives and negatives and give students a voice to actually share their honest opinions is something that truly shows that ElPro International School Chinchwad is in no way worried about, you know, the repercussions, the ramifications, and most importantly, wants to take this discourse forward in the most positive manner, constructive manner possible. And I can see the changes that have been implemented from April onwards, when everybody literally was learning how to walk. We were crawling, we've learned how to walk, and I think EIS Chinchwad is now running. Sugandha, ma'am, kudos to you, management, leadership, and I believe the floor is yours. It's only fitting that you have the final word before we end the stream.
Thank you so much, Anansh. Congratulations to all my students. I think you all have done exceedingly well. Congratulations to the winners. You will soon have your prizes and certificates coming your way. I'm sure you all are excited for that. But a huge round of applause to everybody. It'll make us proud, and I'm very happy with the kind of research you've put in. Thank you, Anansh and Jayant, for steering this entire event so beautifully. Thank you, Jayant. I know you are my students' favorite. So thank you for taking, you know, their calls and their emails at any given point of time, and for training them so well. My heartfelt gratitude to Sir and Ma'am, Mr. Vikram Deshmukh and Dr. Shilpa. I mean, we are so, so honored to have you with us. I'm sure the students are going enriched from today's session, from hearing erudite personalities like you. Thank you for giving them really meaningful insights, which I sometimes the students tend to miss. So I am so glad you could take out some time and speak to them today on this occasion. And I think it was really, really an honorable moment for us to have you with us here. So all in all, I am really happy with the way we all have conducted ourselves today. And yes, like Anansh said, we have more to offer on the platform of eQuest, which we will be continuing tomorrow with our debate and panel discussion. Thank you, everybody.
Yep. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, viewers. Thank you, all the participants, the judges, Anansh, you as well, for making sure that this happens very, very nicely and the quality is maintained. We will see you all tomorrow again. We will start at 4:30 again tomorrow, a debate followed by a panel discussion.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.